This lecture is on reflective writing. You should listen to the lecture on reflective practice before listening to this lecture. Reflective writing is just one of the ways in which you can engage in reflective practice. So what is reflective writing? Reflective writing is writing that involves a consideration of the larger context, meaning, and implications of an idea or an action. So it is a form of writing where you're really looking at, well, what's the big story here? What did it all mean? And what are the implications? What are we going to do from here after what has happened? Reflective writing helps you to recognize the connections between what you already know and have experienced and what you are in the process of learning and experience. It's about looking for and examining the connections between the two. So in the previous lecture on reflective practice, we talked about why reflective practice is worth doing. Reflective writing is a form of reflective practice where you're actually really trying to be quite deliberate and strategic in how is it that you go about getting reflective practice done through writing. And what you do there is you're trying to find the connections between what you already know and have experienced. So these are the things that I know, experience, I've already done my reflective practice on them, I've had higher considerations. And how do I connect this up with what it is that I'm doing now and what it is that I'm learning now? And defining these connections is a very important part of reflective writing. So why reflective writing? Well, it gives you a chance to think about what you're doing more deeply and learn from your experience. Very often you would come to realize by now that we don't often actually think about what is it that we are doing, what is it that we are learning, what is it that we are experiencing. We tend to jump from one experience to another, one learning activity to another, and so on and so forth. Well, by building in distinct spaces for reflective writing, what you are doing is saying, all right, I'm going to stop here and actually think about what it is that I'm doing and how this connects up to the things that I've done in the past and how can I learn from these things moving forward. You have an opportunity to discover how what you know in the class helps you deal with your real world or academic tasks. I mean, this is specific to when you're in the classroom. A lot, if not almost everything that you do in the classroom should be somehow able to make you a better practitioner in your discipline, in this case the media and comm practitioner, or better in accomplishing the various assessment tasks that are put up in front of you. A lot of times we just move from things to things and we don't really get a sense of, well, why am I doing this? How does this link to how I'm going to work out there? Or how is it I'm going to finish my assessments properly? And stopping to have a think about their class activities is a really useful way to make those links. And writing your thoughts down makes it even easier to think about them and make the connections between what you are doing, what you're being taught, and what you're doing. There are a lot of people who prefer to reflect through meditation, reflect through artistic practice. Some people reflect through daily journaling, which is similar to reflective writing, but it is not reflective writing. Some people prefer to, you know, they feel that they're better reflecting in their minds, so they like to reflect while they are going for a walk at night, or they're jogging, or they're exercising. All those activities work and have a particular efficacy, but I believe very strongly that writing is probably the strongest form of reflective practice, at least until you're intellectually and mentally robust enough to perhaps do it in other ways, because writing forces you to put things down on a piece of paper very explicitly that details what you're doing, what have you been learning, what are you going to do next. And what I like about reflective writing reflectively is that it also serves as a source of reference and evidence in your future. So very often if I go through my old journals, you get a very distinct sense of having a personal or professional growth, because you can look at the things or ideas you were grappling with in the past that you've moved beyond and been able to exploit for future activities. And that sense of reference, or that sense of evidence in your growth, can be quite useful for affirmative purposes. Reflective writing is a key to deep learning, where teaching and learning activities Reflective writing is a key to deep learning. And when teaching and learning activities such as reflection are missing, only surface learning can result. What Biggs is saying here is this, that in order to achieve deep learning or deliberative learning or deliberative practice, if you go into a classroom space or you go to any sort of learning environment where you're not actually spending time reviewing what you have learned, be it even minimally going through in the class, what do I know today that I didn't know yesterday, you are only learning how to do things at a very superficial level. Usually these are not things that will stick. These are not things that you will be able to understand the larger point of was. And sometimes for a lot of students, when you're starting out on this journey, you generally will feel that reflective practice in itself is very superficial because it can seem rather indulgent. But as you go along and carry on in time and you do it long enough, and by long enough, I would say a semester, you get a much stronger sense of how this reflective practice is helping you grow. So why is reflective writing so often used as an assessment task? Because it helps you and the people that you're working with examine your learning process, including not only what you've learned, but how you've learned. The reality of the, you know, whether, if I want to be dramatic, the tyranny of any mass industry is that it has to be designed to appeal and to reach the most number of people at the cheapest cost possible. So the learning activities that are designed might not resonate that well with you. You might still get something out of it, but not as much as if they were taught particularly to your style. So when you engage in learning reflective writing, you can slowly develop a very strong sense of what your learning style is and leverage and lean into that for future learnings. So you can make sure that you're not wasting time learning in an inefficient way. Reflective writing also shows how you've made the connections between what you already know and what you're learning at that moment, or in other courses as well, between theory and practice, between something that you taught to you from a conceptual space and how you demonstrate that you use that concept to execute an outcome. And finally, between course material and personal experiences. I know there's always a slight hesitancy to conflate the teaching experience and your life experience, but the reality is that you are who you are and you're formed by your experiences. Whether your experiences are in the teaching space, in the personal space, they all inform who you are. And that connection between how you see the world, how the world is framed for you through your experiences, does have an impact on the way you become a practitioner. So the relationship between your experiences and the course material is something that's quite useful. Reflective writing, I find very useful, particularly in terms of trying to think carefully about what am I doing, how am I doing it, and why am I doing it. The what is not difficult, the what is tends to be heavy on the description. The how is not so difficult, it tends to be heavy on explaining the different things that you did. But the why you're doing it is the hardest one. Why am I learning these things? To what end are these activities being engaged upon? What do I hope to achieve from this? And those are really hard questions to answer, and you cannot answer them in doing reflective practice once a week for, you know, 5 weeks. But it's something that you need to do probably, I would say, daily, if not several times a week for several months. And you'll get better at it as time goes on. And the better you get at it, the better it will clarify your understanding of the world and what you're doing, identifying the questions you have and what you have yet to learn. It gives you sort of a pathway or a map to try to understand what are the different things that you want to learn, or what are the different areas where your gaps of knowledge are that you can fill up and improve your outcomes. One of the hardest things to do is always try to anticipate where the next move is coming from and where your gaps in knowledge are, so you don't get caught out. To learn from mistakes and lessons. Unfortunately, so much of what we do is designed by avoiding failure. Explicitly avoiding failure. Now, the danger with explicitly avoiding failure or setting out only to avoid failure is that, one, usually when things go wrong is where we get to learn the most. But two, if we always, if our first principle is to not fail, then we are always going to go with the safe options. And if you go with the safe options all the time, innovation becomes a real problem. So reflective writing is a really good way to allow yourself to make the mistake, but do something positive and useful with a mistake. Learn from it so that you don't do it a second time. But also find out then how you can go about making that successful. What are the strategies you can use? Reflective writing also helps you become an active learner, where you're engaging in the learning process by asking questions, raising doubts, and also starting to think critically about your ideas, what you're presenting. Active learning is a student who is actively, aggressively even, involved in their learning. They know what they want, and they ask the questions, and they question the teacher in the classroom, what is the point of this? I have this idea. What do you think? I disagree with this, and what do you think? And so on. It's a form of testing your idea, your ideas and your intellectual sort of, let's just say heft for now. As I said to you in the classrooms, it's a real pity that we cannot accommodate failure in the education system, because it would be one of the most useful ways through which you would learn. Failure, again, depends on how you define it. Failure of outcome doesn't mean failure of process. Right? And we spoke about that in one of the classes. And what that means is that just because you've been unable to deliver the outcome that was required, if you go and review and reflect back on the process that got you there, you will know what are the things that you did right, and you will know what are the things that you didn't get right, and you'll be able to do it better the second time around. But if you always manage to take the safe option and do it, that just means you know how to do it the same way, safe way, all the time, which in the long run is also a problem. Finally, reflective writing is also to encourage you to become a long-term reflective practitioner. And that is really the key to lifelong learning, growth, and meaningful change. You cannot just jump from one task to another, from one job to another, from one problem to another. You actually need to stop and have a sense of what it is that you're doing, to reflect on what are the things that let you develop further. There's a lot of interesting research around how boredom is actually an important part of creativity. Okay, so I've explained to you what and why we should engage in reflective writing and why we should engage in reflective writing. So now we're going to answer the question, well, how do I go about writing reflectively? And we're going to talk about three methods today. Method one, we're going to have some users guiding questions. So method one starts off by saying, reflection involves taking a pause to examine your thoughts, beliefs, values, and attitudes, which form the foundation of your understanding. Revisit prior experiences and knowledge. Consider how you think and why you think the way you do. There is no right and wrong answer, but the key is often how and why and not what. And this is a mistake that a lot of people who haven't been taught how to do reflective writing, there's an overemphasis on the what, highly descriptive, and not enough, or if not any sometimes, discussion on the how and why. So some questions you can use to guide your reflective practice, your reflective writing, are things like, what happened during if that event or an experience, why did it happen? What was my role? Why did I have this role? What were my feelings during that experience? Why did I feel that way? What were my thoughts? Why did I think that way? How do I interpret what I experienced? How might this experience mean? What might this experience mean in the context of my course? What other perspective, theories, concepts can be applied to interpret the situation? How can I learn from this experience? So these are just some guiding questions you can use. You're trying to bring together a whole bunch of ideas. And if you look at the questions, it starts off really looking at, well, what happened? Something's happened. What happened? Who was I? Who am I in this experience? How did that make me feel? How did I think about those things? All right, now let's do the next step up and think about, what do those things mean? How do I interpret what I experienced? How does this experience link to the other things that are happening in my life? What can I bring from outside of this experience to help me understand this experience? And lastly, how can I learn from this experience? And that's really saying, moving forward, what can I do differently next time? So that's one method. It's quite a good method. There are different guiding questions you can use. So if you go onto the internet and you search for reflective writing questions or prompts, you'll see a whole bunch of these type of questions. These questions are good because they do the whole life cycle of an event. Another form of creative, reflective writing is from Gibbs, and he also is sort of similar to the previous guiding questions, but he breaks it up into description, what happened, what are you going to do, and it's a non-judgmental space. You're just literally trying to get down. Now, you can do this reflective practice even in group situations, so it doesn't just have to be limited to yourself. Very often, when things go wrong in technically, even if things go right in any corporate environment, you should be running a debriefing session, but definitely if things go wrong. And this is useful methods, again, you can use for that kind of situation. So you start off by descriptions, non-judgmental. Then you talk about your feelings, what were your feelings and reactions. Now, feelings is something that tends to, with some people, evoke a sense of like, well, you know, why do feelings have to do with my job? Because your feelings have a real and significant impact on how it is that you get about doing a task. A simple thing like if you haven't had enough sleep means your reflexes and your attention is low, which can lead to all kinds of problems. Your feelings, if you've had a traumatic experience that morning or that night, the night before, so on, that can impact on how you might behave or if one of your teammates. So feelings are really important. What was good or bad about the experience? You're judging from the description. Analysis, what sense can you make of the situation? Try to understand what happened. Use other experiences, other ideas from outside to understand what was going on. Once you've done all of that, you can start going, all right, what are my conclusions here? You can talk about a very general conclusion, sort of overall, or you can talk about a very specific conclusion. Now, the general conclusion is just sort of, well, from this thing that's happened, this is our overall sense of what's going on. A specific one looks very particularly at your situation or that very particular situation and that way in which different people reacted. Finally, and I think this is one that gets dropped out too often, what are your next action? What's your next action? What are your personal action plans? What are you going to do differently in this type of situation next time? Now, this doesn't only mean that you have to come up with this when things go bad. It also means about maybe you want to come up with something so you can test a new way of doing things next time. It might be you've got a new note-taking software you might want to try, or you have a new task management or project management software you want to try, or there's a new person you want to bring in. So all those things are also part of those things. It doesn't have to be something that's only trying to solve something that went wrong, all right? But you use that, you only come up with these personal action plans through the experience of going through this entire reflective process. Finally, the third method is the DIEP method. This is where we talk about describe, interpret, evaluate, and plan. So you see they're all fairly similar, but they approach things in a different way. So method one looked particularly in terms of almost a Q&A approach. Method two, the Gibbs method, looked at answering questions in a particular sequence. And this method, the DIEP method, looks at things through quite a formalic way. So when we start with description, it actually answers the question, what did I learn? All right, so it's quite explicit, quite clear. It even provides you with writing prompts such as the most interesting thing, insight, theory I read or I felt this week was a significant issue that I've not addressed. One thing I realize now is that. So it gives you very specific writing prompts to start that writing process with. So it starts with description where you're just talking about what happened, focus on what you learned in the details. Follows on by interpret, which is trying to answer the question, well, what does it mean? How might this affect other things that are going on? So this is where you're testing those hypotheses. Now, if you go back to the Klobs Learning Cycle in the lecture on reflective practice, you'll see how this links up, where you're actually putting forward a new hypothesis and then you're testing it and you're having experience. So again, there's some writing prompts. This realization may have important relevance for three reasons. A possible implication is, and so on and so forth. So it tries very this method is really useful if you're struggling and you're not quite sure how to put the sentences together. You can use the writing prompts. The next question is asking you to evaluate, and the question here you're answering is, how is this useful for my deeper understanding of the topic? And you can use writing prompts like the concept of X is valuable for, this understanding is important in a number of ways, first, and so on. Having realized that this, I wonder if... So again, you're using those writing prompts to evaluate what's going on. And then very importantly, next section, never forget the next section, plan how you're going to use this in the future or in practice. How might this learning apply in my future? And very importantly here, that they suggest that you use the future tense to show transfer of knowledge into the future. So you're actually saying, this is what I did, this is what I learned, this is my analysis, and this is how I can use it the next time. And they've even got a writing prompt that you can use there. So that is what reflective writing is, and there's three methods you can use. They're all similar, but they work differently, so you pick the method that you're most comfortable with. Before I go, I just want to point out that I want you to keep a few things in mind. Reflective writing is not the conveying of information. It's not just pure description. It's not about saying this was bad or this was good. Alright? It's not simple problem solving, and I have to really emphasize the next two. It's not a summary of your course notes. I have had many times the students hand in to me what is supposed to be a reflective piece, but is in fact merely a summary of that day's lecture or that day's learning activities or their notes of it, and it's not an essay in the usual sense of the word, right? So what is it? It is your response to the experiences, opinions, events, and new information that you have engaged in. It's your response to your thoughts and feelings. It's a way to explore your learning. I mean, it's really to get out there and sort of, you know, shake yourself into that learning space and see, well, what do I know? It is an opportunity to gain self-knowledge. There's a really powerful thing there about developing a sense of what you have learned. This is what I know now. This is where I've learned. And that gives you a strong sense of esteem moving forward, and you feel more confident in doing what you have to do. A way to achieve better clarity and understanding of what you're learning. If you're running from one class to another class and running from one assessment to another assessment, you never really get to understand with any focus or clarity what are you learning. You're just learning a bunch of things. How do you use these things? It'll be something that comes too late, so it's useful to do that. You also get ancillary benefits, like learning a chance to develop and reinforce writing skills, which is really useful. And then finally, actually make meaning of what it is that you're studying. A lot of what you're studying, and this is particularly for the media and comm sort of space, you know, there are a lot of jobs in the media and comm space that you might end up doing by the time you graduate that do not exist. There's a lot of you that are going to be working in spaces that do not exist, or we cannot understand them existing at the moment. By learning the key things that you need to learn in your disciplinary skills, but also you're starting to learn reflective practice and reflective practice through writing, means you cannot just always enter these spaces having learned what you need to learn, but also being able to decide what it is that you need to learn next. And another advantage is that it helps you very clearly articulate the things that you have learned when you sit in an interview situation. I'd like to end off this lecture by looking at a quote from Donald Schoon, who wrote a very important book called The Reflective Practitioner. And he says that reflective practice is a dialogue of thinking and doing through which I become more skillful. And I think that's something to think about. Thank you.